Welcome back to Lesson 3. I hope you took good notes from our last video and you started to think about how your current plan might be, or might not be, targeting the three critical systems that we talked about. Now, in today's lesson, we're going to talk about one of the most feared aspects of marathon training, the long run. But I'm going to surprise you and tell you it doesn't need to be as long as you think it does. That's right, no 20 to 22 milers or 4 plus hours runs for you. Not only am I going to show you why this works, but I'm going to give you an example of long runs that are even better than 20 or 22 milers. So let's go ahead and head to the whiteboard and I'm going to show you.
Now, as we discussed already, the primary goal in marathon training should be to increase aerobic threshold, utilize fat more efficiently at marathon pace, and build endurance. So where does the marathon long run fit in with these three goals? Let's start by comparing the traditional 20 to 22 miler with what I call the marathon specific 16 to 18 miler when it comes to hitting aerobic threshold, fat utilization, and muscular endurance. Now, research has shown that your body does not see a significant increase in aerobic development, specifically mitochondrial development, when running over 90 minutes. As a 3:45 marathoner, or in about that range, your easy long run pace is likely to be 9:30 to 10 minutes a mile. So a 20 to 22 miler is going to take you a little over 3 hours to finish. Now, you can extrapolate that a little bit if you're a little bit faster or a little slower than this. But regardless, that means you're going to get roughly the same aerobic benefit from going 16 to 18 miles versus 20 to 22. Now, of course, you're going to say, even if there is a slight benefit, isn't it worth it to go 20 to 22? I don't think so, because when you consider the fact that the longer you run, you significantly increase your chance of injury. Your form begins to break down. Your major muscles become weak and susceptible to injury, and overuse injuries begin to take their toll. And I'm not just making it up, research has shown it. So not only are aerobic benefits diminished while injury risk rises, recovery time is also significantly lengthened. The total amount of time on your feet during a 3-hour run adds considerable fatigue to the legs, which leads to significant delay in recovery time. In the long term, this means you can't complete more marathon-specific workouts the following week, which I believe, and research has shown, is a more important component to marathon success. Finally, let's look at pace and how it factors into aerobic threshold. To train a specific physiological system, we need to run at a specific effort level. That means to improve aerobic threshold, you need to run at your aerobic threshold. If you follow a traditional training plan and run an easy to 20 to 22 miler, just barely surviving and getting through the run, you get 0 miles training at aerobic threshold pace. Not 1 mile trains you to run at aerobic threshold. Now, you can't improve an energy system if you never train it. Now, let's compare this to an 18-mile marathon-specific run with a 4-to-5-mile fast finish at marathon pace. The total time for the run will be closer to 2 hours and 30 minutes. This gives you roughly the same aerobic benefit as the 20 to 22 miler. However, you're going to spend 4 to 5 miles running at aerobic threshold and while tired. That's 4 to 5 miles of more marathon specific training than a 22 miler. And you reduce your injury risk by not running over 3 hours. It seems like a no-brainer to me, and I'll detail how to execute this workout momentarily. For now, let's move on to fat utilization. Once again, let's compare the 20 to 22 miler with a 16 to 18 mile fast finish long or surge long run. To teach yourself how to burn fat as an energy source at marathon pace, you have to run at marathon pace with low glycogen reserves. Now, how many miles do you run at marathon pace when doing an easy 20 to 22 mile long run? 0. However, during a 16 to 18 miler with a faster finish, you get in 4 to 5 miles of training to utilize fat as a fuel source while running at marathon pace. Advantage, 16 to 18 miler. Ah, but I know what you're saying. How can I finish 26.2 miles if I only run 16 miles in training? How will I build the muscular endurance? It's a good question. Yes, running 20 to 22 miles is good for muscular endurance. I won't deny that. But how specific is it to the marathon? Meaning, are you going to run easy on race day? Don't you need to improve your muscular endurance while running at marathon pace for an increasingly longer period of time and doing it while tired? During an easy 20 to 22 miler, you never run at marathon pace while tired. So, easy running muscular endurance is improved, but your muscular endurance while you're tired and trying to run at marathon pace is not. That's not very specific to what you're going to experience on race day, unless, of course, you just want to run easy that last 10K. Now, let's compare this to the muscular fatigue during a 16 to 18 miler with a fast finish. You're going to get 4 to 5 miles of running at marathon pace while tired. Plus, if you do things right, like we're going to teach you in lessons 4 and 5, you're going to buttress this long run against a shorter but steadier pace run the day before. So, for example, you may run 1 mile easy, 6 miles at marathon pace, 1 mile easy on Saturday, and then run your full long run on Sunday. Because of the harder running on Saturday, you start Sunday's long run not at 0 miles, but rather at 6 or 8 miles, since that is a level of fatigue and glycogen depletion your body is going to carry over from the previous run. For the traditional 20 to 22 miler, you'll get 0 total miles at marathon pace, and if you follow a traditional schedule, just 22 miles for that entire weekend, because most of them ask you to take the day before the long run off to kind of rest up for that long run. However, when you implement a steady run with a marathon-specific long run, even though it's shorter, you're going to get 11 to 14 miles at marathon pace and 26 total miles for the weekend. Moreover, you'll actually recover from this faster, so you can do another marathon-specific workout in a few days, and you're going to reduce your injury risk. Now, that's not to say you're never going to run or never should run over 18 miles in a long run. This example is to demonstrate that marathon-specific long runs outperform easy long runs when it comes to marathon readiness. If you're faster than 3:30 for the marathon, meaning that 20 miles is going to take you less than 3 hours, or you're running high mileage so that a 20 to 22 miler is less than 33% of your mileage, then going longer is okay. However, you still want to include marathon-specific work. Now that we've talked about the philosophy behind shorter marathon-specific long runs, it's time to give you some example workouts. I like to use what I call a fast finish long run and a surge long run. Both have beginner and advanced long run. The basic fast finish long run is pretty easy. The goal is to teach you how to run faster while low on glycogen, burn fat at marathon pace more efficiently, and physically and mentally prepare yourself to run fast when tired. The execution is pretty simple. Run your normal easy pace for half or three quarters of your long run, so let's say 8 to 12 miles. So your easy pace is going to be about 65% of your 5K pace. Now remember to go ahead and use that calculator we gave you in the first lesson. Then you're going to run 3 to 5 miles at marathon pace. Run easy the remaining 1 to 2 miles to cap off the distance. So here's an example run. 10 miles at normal easy pace, 5 miles at marathon pace, 1 mile easy. Now, we can make this more advanced by increasing the amount of time run at marathon pace. I call this the advanced fast finish long run. It goes a little something like this. Start with 3 miles at easy pace. This gives your body a chance to warm up and get the blood pumping. From miles 3 to 8, which is about 5 miles, you'll target a pace that is 5% slower than marathon pace. For those of you who struggle with math like I do, that's usually going to be about 15 seconds slower than marathon pace. Not quite hard, but challenging. Miles 8 through 13 should be run at marathon pace. Not only is this good practice to help you lock into marathon pace as your legs are getting tired, but you're starting to teach your body to burn fat as your glycogen stores deplete, and you have to continue to run at a moderate effort. Now comes the hard part. Miles 13 through 16, 3 miles, should be about 3 to 5% faster than marathon pace. 3% is going to be about 10 seconds per mile faster than goal pace, which will be very difficult. Again, you're going to be low on glycogen and training yourself to mentally and physically push when you're tired. And run the last mile or two easy, almost as a cool down. The second type of marathon-specific long run are what we call surge long runs. The goal is to surge for 60 to 90 seconds at 10K pace every 5 to 8 minutes. This surge creates a sharp demand for energy and therefore a call for glycogen. This will deplete your stores faster and signal the brain that it needs to conserve, and thus burn fat as a fuel source. It also engages intermediate and fast twitch fibers, tiring them out and forcing your slow twitch fibers to develop. And we're going to talk about more on this muscle recruitment fiber in our next lesson. So as an example, we're going to run the first 10 miles at normal easy pace, at mile 10, surge for 90 seconds, at 10K pace. The exact pace isn't important. It's faster, but not all out. After the 90-second surge, slow back down to easy pace. Maintain this easy pace for 5 minutes, and then surge 90 seconds back to 10K pace again. Repeat 5 to 7 times. Finish off your remaining run distance easy. To make this long run even more marathon-specific, we can incorporate some of the principles we'll learn in our next lesson on lactate clearance to not only train the body to clear lactate quickly at marathon pace, but also to trigger higher levels of glycogen depletion and further improve your ability to burn fat as a fuel source while running at marathon pace. Instead of running easy between the surges, you're going to run at marathon pace as your quote-unquote rest. The surges should be between 10K and half marathon pace, and the marathon pace rest will be 4 to 5 minutes, depending on your ability level. Surging at 10K pace is going to burn through more glycogen than you would remaining at moderate marathon-paced effort. Then, as you slow back down to marathon pace, your body realizes it must conserve glycogen for these 60 to 90 second bursts, and it attempts to use fat as its primary source at this pace. So here's an example of this run. For an 18-mile long run, you do 8 times 90-second surges at 10K pace with 5 minutes at marathon pace between. Usually, I like to start these at mile 9. Finish off the rest of your run after the surges easy. So now you have the marathon-specific long runs that you need to crush your next race. In Lesson 5, we're going to discuss where, when, and how often you should include them, along with other workouts and pace guidelines. But before we get to that, we're going to talk about other marathon-specific workouts you should be including in your training throughout the week. We're once again going to use science and our understanding of marathon physiology to give you some innovative marathon workouts. I know you're going to really love them. So stay tuned for the next video and see you then.